Good morning. This
morning.
Is the reuse subcommittee of the Public Works Commission. Today is January 14th, and I'm calling the meeting to order. First item on the agenda is to approve our minutes from the December 10th meeting. Did everyone have a chance to go over those minutes that Susan sent around via email?
Copies here. Does anyone need a copy?
Does anyone need some time to go through them before we vote on approval?
Good, I just want to.
I only request to get rid of that draft.
I know that bugs you.
Oh, I love it.
You love it.
I wish I knew how to do that.
I'll teach you.
Motion to approve minutes as written.
Is there, yes, Susan?
Before discussion, please. I took the minutes last month, and I did not write down who was here. So this is a guess.
Okay.
So if those who were here, I deleted John's name. Is anyone aware?
Because John wasn't here.
Because John wasn't here.
Yeah.
But I just.
So you didn't delete it, you didn't include it.
I took the minutes from a month before.
Right, okay.
And deleted my name, yes.
Yes. Okay, here. Everyone in the room was here, except for John. And David Shearer, I believe, was here, and I think.
Yes.
Oh,
he was
you
here.
Know what? I think Roe was here, wasn't she?
Yes, Roe was here.
Okay.
Alan?
Yeah, Alan's on here.
Alan's
on
the list.
Okay.
What's her name here?
Maria?
Excuse me?
Maria.
Was she?
Oh, yeah.
Is that her name, Maria?
Maria?
Sitting in the corner over there in the chair.
Maria. Okay.
Who's
excellent.
Maria?
Thank you.
What's Maria's last name?
It's escaping me. It's an Italianish name.
Yeah. I think she volunteered at the last reuse event that we had in October.
And she was at the Toy Swap.
And she was
at the
Toy Swap.
Yeah, no, she's been great. She's been doing some wonderful work.
Yeah, she's really enthusiastic.
Yes.
You know, all of you people are so tired. So great to have this youthful energy come into the reuse committee.
All right, so we'll get Maria's last.
Peter has a motion on the floor to approve the minutes as with the revisions of who attended.
Second.
Anybody opposed? All in favor?
Aye.
Great. Okay. The Recenter Working Group report. Alan or Mac or Diana?
Alan.
Getting something from Alan.
Okay, next.
We could do that.
Go ahead,
Mac. Skype someday.
Well, we have broken up into yet more subcommittees. And we have a committee that's working on the reconfiguration and improvement of the space. And we have a subcommittee that's working on intake procedures. And Susan, help me. What? And Diana, we have other groups?
I'm looking for it here.
I missed the last meeting when the subcommittees emerged.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is roof committee?
No.
No, well, that's part of the.
It's all Susan.
I can't remember either.
I'm sorry, guys. I'm not finding that.
I know that we are working on the space, rearranging
right.
and designing the
right.
indoor space.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm working with Joan on the sign for outdoors. I took the sign to my house.
Okay.
And we're trying to make a design that goes with our logo better.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Basically, it was around procedural things. So we grouped. Three, four different procedural ways to.
Right, because it became clear, I mean, we have a really limited amount of time before we're opening again. So we thought, how can we focus our energies to get some things? And we also prioritized what things absolutely had to happen as opposed to things that we would like to have happen.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the reason I don't have those notes is because I was there on my desk and I was planning to pick them up and send them out to people. So. I apologize. I will do that and I'll send it out to the entire group.
Yes.
Roger. I don't know how difficult or useful it would be, but was there any attempt to catalog the different things that were taken in and the things that went out and stuff that we couldn't give away and we had to recycle.
Oh yes, and Maria has been working on, or Maria's typed it all up.
Oh.
Yeah, no, I mean, we're trying to, and we're going to assign basic weights to each of the categories so that we can have an estimated tonnage that we've diverted. So, yeah, she's really been great. So, it's really wonderful. I've said it before and I'll say it again. In this group, as many groups have the potential of doing, it's just this amazing collection of skills and abilities, and everybody contributes what they, you know, something that they're good at, and it's really a beautiful thing. I just need to say that again since it's 2016.
Yeah, and part of the response to what you just asked is Susan and I are at this point going to work on reviewing the list of materials that comes into the recenter and what we can accept and what we can't accept, and update that based on the experiences that we had this past year. And we're also, one of the thorny issues to deal with is the question of what we refer to as the green sticker problem, which is when stuff comes in that we might be able to get a home for, but we're not sure. We don't want to reject it. We can ask the people to pay the disposal fee, and then we take it with the green sticker on it. It's a cumbersome system because the people come in. Well, I don't know if I should go through the whole thing, but basically,
sure. Yeah, you should.
Okay, so people arrive at the center. Let's say they have a piece of furniture that needs some repair, but basically is a solid piece of furniture. So the question is somebody really going to take this and repair it or not? You know, and if not, it's going to eventually end up in the trash. And who's going to pay for the fee? We can't pay for it. So that person comes into the gatekeepers, and the gatekeepers are trying to decide whether we would want it or not, and whether or not they should put this green sticker on it and charge for it. And then we're not always on the same page with the gatekeepers, because we have seen some things, for example, go very quickly that they might say, nobody's going to want that, you know. So in some cases, they might want to charge for some. We don't want to get into overcharging because we don't want people who are coming in to think they're going to have to pay to throw away stuff that it's really likely somebody else is going to want. So we're talking about this and trying to come up with a better system. And there's also, you know, we tried last year to kind of go back and forth between the reset, like if the gatekeepers had a question, they would ring a bell or call us over or whatever and consult with us. But that doesn't always work when things get really heated out there and really intense because everybody's running around trying to accomplish different things. So that's definitely a weak point that we want to, in the system, that we want to try to improve upon.
I just had a thought. We're talking about repair cafes, but those are pop-up events. It would be interesting if there were space in the annex. We had some tools, whatever. Piece of furniture came in that a volunteer could just come and fix it.
Yeah, we have that intention. We have a workbench in the office actually, and there are occasions that we do that. But if somebody wanted to volunteer to come and be that person every week, that would be great.
Or we want to recruit somebody that would do that. That'd be great.
We just haven't had the staff. Sure. We haven't had enough people to have one person take off and do repairs.
I know. I'd be willing to be trained to be that person. Because I know nothing about that, but I have a lot of interest repairing furniture, that sort of thing. I'd love to do that.
Cool.
Yeah, I mean, you know, part of what we talked about is with the opening of the annex part next spring, it's going to be a little more complicated out there because that area is going to require a volunteer's at least partial attention because there's bulky stuff in there and so on and so forth. And so. There's probably going to need to be somebody that's kind of paying attention to that area and trying to make sure that there's somebody in there when people go in there. And also, we want to devote a little bit more thought to the intake question, because sometimes we've had volunteers that have not been a part of all our conversations about intake, be intake people, and
yeah.
end up taking stuff that was maybe not appropriate.
Mm-hmm.
And so maybe a little more specialized training for input intake people. And then, yeah, a possible repair person. I mean, so, you know, all this means, A, perhaps more people, and B, some training for people that take these more specialized roles, and that's part of the conversations that we're having too.
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
Good. Diane, anything else about the working group? No?
Alan and I and Peter met about shelving, and so we're going to change around the shelving a little bit, but I think it's not terribly interesting.
Well, and I don't know that this group is aware that the Wednesday, one of the mid Wednesdays in December, a bunch of people were out at the recenter and they rearranged the annex, and Diana did some painting, and I think the rearranging of the annex was probably the big exciting, that and the painting was something that has been accomplished since people have been out there.
Is getting some light in there something that we need to do?
Yes.
But we can't, right? The city is doing that?
Well, so the reason why that was put on hold was because based on the condition of the roof, it kind of depends on what kind of lighting mm-hmm. is in there.
Well,
so
what if it was a floor
lamp?
If
the roof is still, there was a lamp installed, it's not adequate. And because the roof was leaking, do we have them install, you know, we can't have them install what we have next door, so then you're limited to outdoor lighting and outdoor fixtures. So we had talked about, Ned and I had talked about getting one of those temporary lights that could be used on Saturday mornings to illuminate, you know, one of those kind of builder construction lights. Until we figured out the roof situation.
And what's the status of the roof situation?
Status of the roof situation is that the roofer has been given prevailing wage information and he hasn't gotten back to us, so I need to ping him.
Okay.
Although $7,200 is not bad actually for the entire roof.
But that's not with prevailing wage.
Oh, how much is that going to change?
Well, we don't know if it's going to change, and we don't know if what he used was prevailing.
He knows it wasn't.
He didn't check it, but we don't know if there's a variation.
Yeah. So it's possible that he pays his people close to prevailing wage, in which case it's not a problem.
Yeah.
But we also don't use that whole space, so I would think an argument could be made for our budget could pay for a portion of it, and if it went over the $7,000, you know, maybe since we don't use at least half of that whole space, that the funds for the rest of it could come from another pool.
Yeah, it's not, I think from what I understood, there was commitment to having the roof repaired. And I think that Ned did, you know, we were gonna use the money, that the remaining $10,000. The problem is, if it goes over $10,000, it's a completely different process that needs to be. So we don't want the quote to be over $10,000. That's all.
Got it.
We're probably going to be good unless it goes over $10,000.
But the whole roof being done is good because that gives us an opportunity to use the whole space eventually if we need it. You know.
Or the city to use whatever.
Don't say
that
out loud.
No. Yeah.
We do have clamp lamps and other bits of lighting, but if the roof is leaking, it's not a good idea to have a lot of electrical wires and stuff hanging around in there.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Toy wrap.
Toy wrap. Okay. Approximately, the estimate is 250 people attended, given the lines coming in.
How was the line at opening?
Long. After 125 wins, there were about 75 people, a little bit more maybe left outside. So then they all filtered in, and some left, of course, but mostly that was about the max, and that's about the max capacity.
We had a clicker.
Yeah, 257 was on that.
So there weren't very many people that came after the initial line.
Not many, no.
No.
That's been the historical.
Maybe.
Just in terms of the timing 40, of the event.
40 or something.
You know, we would keep talking about shutting it down earlier.
Yeah, which might be not a bad idea because it really doesn't do much at 11 o'clock anymore.
Right.
There were, as far as the participants in the raffle, that actually turned out 882 tickets were in the raffle total. So about 176 participants according to that, more or less.
How many?
I'm going to say 176 people participated, based on the numbers.
Uh-huh.
The most popular thing, 109 for the Wii game system. Lego Disney Princess, 55. Playmobil, anybody can look at this if they want. That interesting. But despite not too raffle, there are still 16 people who threw their entire ticket into the boxes, or some of these are the same person who just didn't get it, but beyond me. How would
into
you
the
know?
Boxes, what do you mean?
Meaning they threw,
they didn't
not
put
just
their names on
the
tickets.
They were chosen, they couldn't have been contacted.
Oh.
Yeah. Well, they had to be there anyway, so from that stance, but some of these I can't, Melissa, I suppose that is. But anyway.
We did have one unfortunate situation. A woman won a group of Transformers. It was some young kid's entire collection of Transformers, including two boxes of brand new Transformers. Ooh. They were probably 20 of them. I mean, it was an amazing little find. And so we had grouped them, we had put them all together and had them as a raffle, and the woman that won it was thrilled to pieces. And Peter knows more about the story, but she set it down, and Peter said, you know, we can't be responsible for that. You know,
I said, please don't leave it there.
And she left it there, and somebody took it.
Oh. Oh, man.
So I made multiple announcements on the with the speaker asking people to look for it and please return it.
Yikes.
So, yeah, that was unfortunate, but that's one of the reasons also we didn't want people to leave stuff too much in front because it's
I think
too
Peter's
easy.
Idea of having the raffle on the stage worked very well. The only problem was that there was a period where there were a lot of people trying to get up there to put their tickets in, and it got rather crowded and a little crazy, so we had to hold people back and have them wait.
But not having that on the stage also helped a whole lot because that was a big problem last year.
There's people storing their stuff on the stage.
Well, just bulky, trying to carry, looking at stuff, you know, they're carrying their winning findings.
Is there handicapped access to the stage?
Yeah, that was.
We had 57 people total put their name. We got 57 new email addresses.
Wow, that's great.
Which is more, that's what the purpose of this was as much as anything. And we actually got two gift certificates from Big Y for $25. So Susan's already informed them and sent a nice letter.
Oh, you know what? I only heard back from one of the people. So we might have to drop another.
What'll happen with those 57 names that we got?
I'm sorry?
The 57 email addresses.
They need to be put into the store email list. Yeah, we still have their slips.
So they're just
free.
They signed up to get more information about events.
Yeah. Well, they signed up to
volunteer
necessarily. Join our mailing list. They signed up to join our mailing list.
Uh-huh. And the reason for that is I see this as very much more malleable if we make it into a constituency of folks. So this is political season. You know, looking at it as if we're trying to get something political accomplished. So these are our members. These are our our folks. And to be able to go to them for volunteers and being able to go to them with ideas of stuff and getting people to come into our group, I see this as the most important thing, actually. So, but just to finish up on the toy thing, I think next year a major difference will be that folks, if they don't sort it at home, they're going to have to sort it there. So we will give them the trays. You know, if they come in and they got all these bags and stuff, then they go over to some tables around the edge.
You mean when they contribute it?
When they come in with it, they need to put it in trays so that we can see it and manage it from there. A lot of the problems are, Mac was standing there forever, you know, pulling things out of bags.
Yeah.
So it just takes way too long.
Roe had that issue also. And at some point on Friday night, we just said, okay, you know what? If you want to give it, that's fine, but you're going to have to put it together. And we should have done that right from the beginning.
And I meant to thank you for supporting me on that.
but you know, the problem, and we knew that from the beginning, that we shouldn't be taking those things, but the stuff just starts coming in so fast that you lose your ability to manage exactly what's
your
coming.
Your goal becomes reducing the line,
that's
not
right.
taking in toys.
Yeah.
Right. The way I set the tables up was that we would do that at the tables where stuff comes in, and that's not a good idea. It's a good idea only to have those tables for when they've got their stuff sorted into boxes or something visible, trays, I should say. Then they can bring it over and handle it from there. That will cut at least half the time out of it, I think.
I'd like to think about being able to take things in at the recenter too. Specifically for the toy exchange, people bring things, because I felt like a lot of what was coming in, people had cleared out closets for months ago, and they'd thrown everything in a bag, and they were like, oh yeah, this puzzle did have all its pieces, there must be one down here in the bottom of this bag. And so it was, we need to offer the service to the people who are donating also with what they're trying, well, they're just trying to clear out their stuff.
Mm-hmm.
They don't really care that much about giving us what we want. But we need to find some middle ground.
We can expand that a little bit. If we're going year-round, as let's say the toy exchange is one of our main focuses, then we can, in fact, collect toys all year round, including for an auction. At this point, I don't want to give up the raffle. Keep the raffle, but maybe add a collector's toy exchange, maybe at 11 o'clock in a small auction or something, just try it out. But definitely keep the raffle, and realizing how much incentive that is for people to come next day, et cetera, and to bring stuff. Oh, another little problem. One person there had standing waiting for the announcements of what was. They had three, so he had 15 tickets in his hand. So I think the smart, and I'm noticing this going through the smart people. The wife brings something, the husband brings something, the kid brings something. So now they get a lot more raffles. So I think we need to look at whether or not we want to proportionate.
Well, what if your friend comes and they need to go because they're taking care of your kids, and they give you their raffle tickets because they put theirs in and they can't wait for the thing to happen? It'd be impossible.
No, I know it's I'm throwing it out there because I think people are finding some ways to game it.
It will always happen, I'm sure.
But
I mean, if we really want to go that route, if we continue to have the raffle, separate, like on the stage, you can just have people as they come up the stage. You know, we had somebody there to kind of do crowd control. You can just ask to see their tickets, and if they've got a fistful of tickets, you can ask. Well, why do you get so many tickets, if we want to go that way. But I doubt that it's that much of a problem, although, there were people definitely gaming, but it's going to happen.
People need to be there to win. Why?
Because otherwise they're having to deal with how to get it to the person.
Yeah, it becomes an administrative nightmare to get things to people. And then you have to store it while you're waiting for them to pick it up. I've done a silent auction, and it just becomes nightmarish. And then, 3 weeks later, they haven't picked it up, and then you have to draw another name. It's just better for them to take it away.
Let's wrap up the toy wrap.
Yep. That's pretty, we can improve it next year. I think we should look at whether or not to do this year round with the idea of the highlight being an actual auction, so that we can get in better stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But that would be something we'd sort of advertise at all our events, maybe, and at the recenter too.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good handle.
Fundraising.
Yep.
So other than being firmer on people sorting things in advance and not giving large boxes of jumbled stuff. What other improvements are we talking about for next year? What are the other improvements?
Cleaning stuff. Some of the stuff that comes in really needs to be.
Yeah, we had a little table with.
Yeah, it'd be nice to have a tad more organized.
Mm-hmm.
There again, I think the people can. So
right.
We can take it if you, and here's some cleaning stuff.
Right.
You know, if you clean this up, I think we've got to get them to do more
yeah.
work. We're trying to do as volunteers too much work.
Mm-hmm.
Frankly, we need to think of this as the board. You know, the reuse committee is the board for the. Now we're going to go out and get other people mostly to do the stuff as much as we can. Because
we have that issue in co-housing with committees, you know, it really becomes a, for some reason, well, people who are on a committee are often drawn to the work, but it just means that when you have a committee that has a lot of work, you end up doing a lot of work, and we're trying to get people to, everybody else to,
yeah.
to participate.
Right. So other improvement suggestions?
I actually wrote down a lot of stuff here, which I can't go over all this right now. It's not.
If we're going to ask people to do stuff, though, it's got to be really well organized and set up so that they don't have to think too much about it. Because a lot of people just want to drop stuff off.
Yeah.
Right.
They just want to come and go.
We can keep this on the agenda for next month, Susan. Peter will have a chance to write up his notes.
Yeah.
And then we can spend another 5 or 10 minutes on it.
It's mostly just on how to do it a little bit better with the doors and the air, et cetera, et cetera. But
okay.
It might be good to have the raffle wheelchair accessible, too. Like have it along one wall or something instead of on the stage. Have it separate but accessible.
2016 event schedule. Susan, is that your?
Yes, and I was not able to work on looking at dates as far as all the various Jewish holidays and state holidays, and I usually look that up and have that in advance. So I suggest that we, you know, talk about generalities, and then I will go and do that, and we can finalize it next month. We traditionally have done a recycle rally. We've done the pot, free pot.
That's a collaboration.
At the SOS event?
Yep.
With the SOS, right.
What date is SOS usually?
First Saturday in May, I think.
Yeah.
The first
That's
Saturday.
Not right,
it's,
first or
it
second,
is just before,
I don't remember.
Yeah, it's just
it's
before,
day
Mother's,
before
day.
Mother's Day.
So Saturday the 7th, May 7th.
Okay, so traditionally we've done the rally, the pot exchange, tag sale. There's some other things that we've done.
Styrofoam, is that it?
That's the rally.
Okay.
When's Pulte Ridge Plastics?
Well, what about the opening events for the recenter?
Well, so last
Something
year
there.
We actually didn't do the tag sale in the spring because of the opening of the recenter.
So this year is going to be a reopening.
So we can, I mean, this is all up for discussion. What's that?
Reopening.
So in the fall, we also do a rally.
And a tag sale.
I'm sorry?
And a tag sale.
And a tag sale. And we had the reuse showcase.
We may or may not have a costume swap with the tag sale.
Mm. And then the toy.
So the rally is Bucky with plastic, styrofoam, shredding, that kind of
yep.
stuff.
Now, I feel like we're missing something in the spring.
Well, haven't we done a bulky plastic thing in the
that's
spring?
That's the rally.
Yeah, that's the rally.
Rally.
Okay, yeah.
Well, we did have a tag sale.
We've had an arts event sometimes, usually, but.
That's in the fall.
Yeah, and it's often
costumes. Hazardous waste collection,
yeah, that's
medical,
us,
sharps.
But I think we could advertise it.
Yeah, I usually do on June.
Electronics? Do we do electronics?
We don't.
No. Well, that's
with hazardous waste.
Yeah, that's with hazardous waste, and that's usually done by the schools.
I'd like to also mention the spelling bee, if we can be part of that again, although again, I won't be here this year again. So I don't know if that's something you'd be interested in or find someone else.
I'll have to check. What's the date?
March 30th.
I'll be in town.
We'll talk about
it. I could do it. What did I do for that last year? I went and
Jonathan
Goldman was involved.
Yeah.
And there was one other volunteer.
And,
Alicia.
Okay, do you need the events?
Our intern, wasn't she? Oh, no, she wasn't. She was in school.
No, it was Alicia, and Alicia wasn't supposed to do it. There was someone else that was going to do it who couldn't, and called Alicia, and she did it the last second.
This is spelling bee. Did we have a team?
We did.
Okay.
Oh, no, not in the bee. We take care of the composting.
It was a zero waste event.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be.
So one question is, are there other events that we would like to add to the list as we're discussing? So we talked about doing some kind of a repair thing. Is that something that we want to add to the slate? And then we can talk about if there's something we want to cross off. We have, as somebody said, done an art thing in the past. Debbie was not able to make it today. I don't know that she's willing to spearhead that. I think we last year decided that, as fabulous as it is, our goal is waste stream diversion and reuse. And while art is fabulous, the actual quantity of stuff that's diverted because of that is not.
Significant.
It's not significant enough. We thought that we should put our energies into other things, like the recenter and stuff like that. So that's why we decided not to do the art thing. There are other groups that are doing this kind of thing, like the Loop. And so, do we want to? Is that something that we want to pursue? And we decided last year we did not. Mm-hmm. So I assume that Debbie is kind of in the same mindset. It would be really, really fabulous if there was an arts group that would take this on and we could help and support. Mm-hmm. Right now, that hasn't happened. But Debbie did try to get some people excited about it, and it just didn't happen.
What if we approach the fellow from Loop and ask him if he wants to do the same thing indoors as mm-hmm. opposed to outdoors at Captain Jack's, which mm-hmm. is where they do it,
mm-hmm.
and just let them run it?
Yeah. And so our role would be what?
Promotion.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Intermediary between the city and the
country. Because they had 25 at least exhibitors, 25, 30. I don't know how many we had. Do you remember how many we had? No.
We had as many as 30. Mm-hmm. It was high 20s or 30s.
Mm-hmm.
Low 30s.
Well, just from memory, it would have probably filled our space. The Loop show would have filled our space pretty much the same. And other people could be invited.
Well, I went to Loop actually this year, and it seemed like they only had like maybe 15.
No, it was 25. I'm sure, yeah.
Well, the day I went, it didn't seem very big. I mean, I was like, oh, this is it? I just was surprised.
Mm-hmm.
Well, another possible event is a repair cafe, if we can get it organized, get enough volunteers.
Mm-hmm.
I don't imagine doing one until late.
Yep.
Well, would you do it at the Reeves Center, or would you do it at somewhere more centrally located?
I guess it depends on the equipment needed by the people who volunteer. So
definitely suggest trying to do it indoors.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah,
but we don't have that capability out there, because if people are coming and...
Yeah.
I thought about the lamp thing, mm-hmm. it just wouldn't have worked. We didn't have the facility for it.
And an alternative would be, again, waste stream diversion through technology would be to, like we talked about, making cold frames, for
uh-huh.
example. We had a workshop on making cold frames.
Yeah.
Get some power saws out there and just have really selective reuse projects that DIY projects that people could do. So we could organize one of those for late August.
Well, keep you in the loop. I'll pick up again with the lamp guy who whose daughter didn't seem to be as cooperative as I thought she was going to be. Mm-hmm. For something indoors at Smith Oak, maybe in March.
We don't usually do events until April. Like usually our schedule starts April, May, June. Yeah. We don't do July, August. We do September, October, November, right? Is that what we're talking about?
Well, we haven't. Doesn't mean we can't.
No, the reason...
Except that we have limited people working on things.
Right.
I don't know. I feel like I can't maintain a year-round schedule with this.
And weather's a real problem in March. We can get a snowstorm.
Yeah.
Right, but it would be indoors. In other words, it would be a Saturday morning thing or something. And if the group is still interested, I'm willing to pursue that tomorrow. I'd be happy to be the coordinator for it.
Let's talk about what we do each month. December, we have the toy exchange. That's pretty much set, right?
Right, that's set for December, good point.
First Saturday, usually?
It's, I think the first Saturday is the ski sale, so we have to go the second.
Okay. So second Saturday is what we'll try for?
Yes. So the costume swap has to be in October.
That's December 10th, by the way.
Okay. The
is
pod
costume
exchange
swap?
Is obviously always, what is
that's
it?
That's May 7th, we think.
When did we have the tag sale last year?
We didn't have a spring one.
We didn't have a spring one, right, that's what I thought.
The rally was the week before the SOS exchange, I think?
I don't think we should do it that, I think we should try to do one a month. If we can't, like if we're planning.
Sure.
Things more reasonable.
But the SOS pod exchange is...
Right, that's set. So, but yeah. I'm just thinking we shouldn't do a rally the week
April
before.
April then,
right,
is what
if we can avoid it, yeah.
Well, the nice part about the rally the week before is people did bring a lot of pots.
Yep.
Uh-huh. And we gave them to the SOS. Uh-huh. They wanted them. They came
true.
And took them all. So
and there were
a, nice
a lot of pots. A lot of pots. It's really, you need to think about that in terms of scheduling.
What about 2 weeks apart? Would that be too much, too long
the,
for
the,
storage?
It's not too much. It's not a problem. The only issue is that's school vacation, but...
Yeah.
We just had our Christmas tree collection last Saturday. It was the first Saturday, and we have it one more. This Saturday is our last one. And Deb suggested that we consider having a pellet bag collection with the Christmas tree, because she said it's kind of mid season, and some people might be interested in bringing pellet bags. So I just wanted to throw that out there. And this group doesn't necessarily even have to be involved in that, but I thought you'd
want to
hear about that.
Yeah, I would love, part of what I'm interested in doing with this list is getting a thing that we can send out to everybody,
mm-hmm.
at least digitally. If mm-hmm. we can't afford to do a citywide mailing, which I really support,
mm-hmm.
I think we should at least have a full year schedule that we can send out for people to know what's coming up.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I think Christmas trees and pellet bags in January could be a thing.
It'd be nice to have the schedule right on the counter out there.
Yeah,
we
or
do.
Everywhere.
We do, guys.
Yeah, that's
we
what
have
I thought.
Paper. We just don't send it out digitally or
people
to
people just
the
don't
mail.
Seem to know. It's not what they have on their fridge.
So we're talking about the rally. If we do it 2 weeks before, that would be 4/23. 1 week before is 4/30.
But is that school vacation week?
I don't know.
It probably is, but you know that's not necessarily an issue.
Right.
Right.
based on, it could or couldn't be, yeah.
I mean, I'm not sure that's enough of a reason not to do it that day, mm-hmm. just because it's the end of vacation.
Well, families with school children are big supporters of our efforts often, so some of them might not be around, so.
If storing the pots,
good.
If storing the pots isn't an issue though, is 3 weeks an issue? I mean, if 2 weeks isn't an issue, is 3 weeks an issue?
We stored them at Smith Oak.
Right.
Tim was willing to put them somewhere, so as long as he's willing to do that again, it's not that much of an issue.
Well, that would be the beginning of the vacation. You didn't need the
The other issue is the fact that is that's when we're opening the reuse center.
April 2nd.
April.
Yeah. April 2nd is the opening of the reuse center.
I do got to say that the pot swap doesn't take a lot of volunteers. I mean, John and I have done it ourselves, and you know, you've probably done it yourself.
It's mainly an SOS event.
SOS. You just sit there and manage the flow.
So one thing that we might consider, too, is because it's our first reopening, do we want to do something, you know, have it open to the public? I mean, you know, do we want to make an event out of our opening month? That's something that we could do. I don't know what would happen other than maybe some repair stuff or something like that.
I think we're overcommitted if we, because as Joan is wont to say, it's just like 2-3 months away, and it's a lot of planning to go into another event, a major event.
Right.
I'm just brainstorming
what things we could do, because as we look at the list that we have, there are some things we want to off cast. So we need to call the Gazette to see if they're going to be doing a tag sale again, and that would be a good predictor. You know, do we want to do 2 a year, or do we just want to go down to 1 a year? Do we want to let go of that one and focus on something else? I just wrote down compost party, because Diane and I have had conversation, and Ruthie Woodring from Peak Pedal People as well had conversation about building more awareness about composting. We talked about having a composting kind of information kiosk maybe out at the recenter at some point. But do we want to have an event about compost? You know, is that something that you guys would be interested in supporting? I don't know. I just thought I'd throw that out there.
It would be nice to have somebody else to run it and just offer our space as a place to do it.
Right. There are plenty of people out there with passion.
Right.
Diana being one of them.
Yeah, I'm puzzling over what would we call people to bring their compost on one day for an event. Like, right. I'm puzzling about what it would be.
Yeah, and hot compost.
Rather than taking compost, you could show off different composters.
It could be more an
educational event than a collection event.
Yeah,
that would be excellent. Well, you know, it's a lot easier to compost when it's warm out, so that'd be an excellent demonstration to have at the reopening.
It's just an idea,
summer.
You know. Yeah. And then the cold frame. So the springtime. I think with the tag sale is the question based on the Gazette situation. We know we're going to have reopening, and that's going to take a lot of our time. And we've got these other things, and I have the hazardous waste day, which is a big project. So I would suggest that we keep our spring kind of, that we don't go any further than this, and that we even consider just having the one tag sale again this year.
In the spring or in the fall tag sale? Fall. How about June for the rally then, instead of April, since we have our opening in April?
Yeah, we could do that. Let's write opening on here too.
You want to do it early before the schools let out, so the kids are still here. You know, before kids go away.
Well, you also want to do it when people are cleaning. It's spring cleaning. People clean up their garages.
That's the rally.
The
rally.
I think we
bulky rigid plastic.
Get so much more in the spring generally than we get in the fall.
No, I meant June. If we're going to do something in June.
Early in June.
Early June is better.
So you're suggesting maybe even the rally in June?
Yeah.
Yes.
And do you think that people will be okay with that? Because people say, I've been holding my styrofoam. You know, so I tended to do it more in the beginning of the spring for that reason.
That just makes two events in April.
I understand. And then the other thing, just to put it out there, is as
John said, when we had leftover pots, which could then be brought to the pot swap.
Right.
So if we did that in April, we wouldn't have that.
I would advocate that we should do the rally the last week of April, even though the pot exchange is the next week, it only takes one or two volunteers.
Okay.
So it's not really like we're doing two events 2 weeks in a row.
I like the idea of having it right before the pot exchange.
Okay.
Well,
that's fine. So yeah, it makes sense with the spring cleaning and with so
okay.
April is the rally.
Okay.
Well, maybe we'll do the opening as just the opening, and it's not. We won't make a big event out of the opening of the retailer.
Yeah. I'm not sure we need to make a big. I mean, based on how many people were coming out at the end of last year, I think we have a constituency for the recenter, and it's not that important to do a big splash.
I think if we do any kind of a splash, it might be a good idea to do the teacher splash. For our grand reopening and maybe have a teacher event, because in the fall they have a lot of stuff going on. I just feel like we need to build awareness for the area K-12 teachers about the
I love the idea of having topical events at the reuse center.
Well, that's what I'm thinking.
I think that's great
basis.
That's a terrific idea.
Topical events.
Yeah, just have teachers come out.
Uh-huh.
On another Saturday, you could have another constituency come
but
out.
But somebody else could
really
work, we're just there.
Yeah.
And, you know, just the idea of having a theme. You know, we can have an opening theme, a different one every year, or...
Yeah, we talked about the teacher sending teachers like a little pass that they could come for one visit. You know, that's what we talked about doing. So we could certainly do that in April, or just have an opening event.
Well, that would be August.
We won't have a lot of stuff.
That's the thing. We won't have a lot of stuff at that point.
Teachers set up their rooms in August, though.
Right.
So that's when that would be a good time for them.
But they don't have time in August because they've got all sorts of other stuff going on. So I thought if they learn about it in the spring, then they can start.
Right.
Looking in the summer, and then it's more of a
ongoing thing.
So then we have fall. So we'll check into the tag sale. Do we want to have two tag sales or just one?
Yeah, I think one
at the moment.
And one in the fall. So I'm gonna do this just to get it up. So then in the fall we've got a rally. We did a reuse showcase, and we talked about doing that again. I was going to talk about this in new business, but I'll tell you here. I got a call from the director of the Northeast Recycling Council, and she is very good friends with the librarian in South Deerfield, who raved about our reuse showcase, Diana, and said it was such a fun thing, and she wants to do something somewhat similar in the February-March timeframe at the South Deerfield Library. So she wanted to know, so I said that I would bring it up at this meeting and see if there were people who would be willing to talk to her on the phone. And I said we certainly could give her the contact information from the people who participated in our event, and probably the contact information of the people who participated in our art show and sale. So she'd have that, and if there are any of you that would be willing or interested in helping her and you know, being involved in that, that would be great. But she's very, very excited about that. She wants to do a whole kind of reuse thing. So I'll put it out. Is anyone interested in at least speaking with her on the phone about it?
Speak on the phone as an exhibitor.
Uh-huh.
That would be reuse.
We have the pictures that we've pulled together for display of things that people did outside of that event.
And those got put, do you remember where they got put?
You were taking them down, I think. I thought they went into the office, or maybe they took them.
Yeah, maybe they're in the office. Or
what about those materials we had for the Bay State? Remember Bay State had that little thing on Earth Day?
Right.
We had some materials out for that.
Bay State.
The neighborhood. Remember that at the Fiker School they had that event that Mac you went to, right?
Yeah.
And you presented.
I'm trying to remember what I did.
I think you brought the trifold.
Yeah, we brought the trifold.
Thing
trifold.
About the recenter. Yeah, we could certainly have recenter information given to the librarian.
Sure. Which they can freely, you know, reuse for their own purposes.
I assume Debbie would be here, so she would have some passion around this too, and Alan, but they're not here, so I will talk to them.
February, March doesn't feel like the right time for me. That's what I'm going to
question. Okay. But would you, as organizer of the event, would you be willing just to talk to her on the phone?
Sure.
Okay. So
Peter and Diane. Yes. Yeah, a couple of things. I mean, if the Gazette is going to do a tax sale again in the fall,
they did it in the spring.
But okay. Didn't they do two last year?
It's on Susan's list of contacts.
Okay. I mean, to me, the tax sale thing is, you know, not really exactly what our mission is about in terms of, so, you know, if we feel
in
like...
In terms of diversion?
Not so much. I mean, it's a service to the public, but it just feels to me like, you know, there's a lot of professionals there, basically, that we're doing an event for these professional flea market people. And, you know, I mean, they are reusers and they sell reused materials, but I don't know. I'll leave it at that. But
I think my personal feeling is that it's a really great event, and if you hold it regularly, people will know about it as an easy way to offload stuff. The key is, are we accessing the right people? Do we want to have it have the timing such that we can get Smith College students who are headed out and clearing out their dorms? You know, are we targeting the right people? The professionals are always going to be there.
Right.
Unfortunately, the professionals are time consuming, and they're the ones that seem to cause the most challenge for us administratively.
Right.
So that's unfortunate, but I think there's great value in having a simple event where you can just drive your car up and sell a few things for a very affordable amount of money. That's a service that is promoting reuse that is really great. The question is that worth what we're having to deal with because
right.
of the permanent professional scene out there?
I guess part of what goes on in my mind too is that I feel like we have limited resources, and there's a tension between the pop-up events and the recenter. And the recenter is, to me, are paramount. It's not that these events aren't good and important, and they occupy different niches than the recenter, but you know, we're also trying to figure out how to get more people involved with the recenter and take some of the pressure off the people that have been really putting a lot of time out there. And I'm just concerned about us spreading ourselves thin, basically.
Well, in terms of that, Mac, if you're worried about volunteers, the tax sale does not require, I think, a couple of volunteers is all that gets.
Mm-hmm.
The SOS, the most it ever gets is a couple of volunteers. It's the rallies where the competition is for the volunteers, and that's where we, you know, really had issues
mm-hmm.
last year in terms
and
of sharing.
And it is true that the tag sale and the cost and the toy exchange are really the only events that we do that conflict with the recenter.
Mm-hmm.
Or that conflict or overlap with the recenter.
The first rally, we ended up having no volunteers because the recenter was open. The second rally, we had dozens of volunteers.
Right,
because
the
recenter
was closed.
So maybe we even think about not doing it in the spring at all. Because that was the problem. I mean, Dave and I were the only two people there with your son and my wife.
Yeah, but the rally is something people really do depend on because they stockpile stuff.
But if we can't get volunteers, then the reality
is... Well, so then maybe we have the rally in late March where we open the recenter.
But then again, that's when we're fixing the recenter. That's when we're in a mad finish up, you know, all the things that need to be done to open
right.
up the recenter.
We're talking 2 months from
Peter.
Now.
If all our events were actually... a place where we can advertise the recenter. I mean, really have a table of our, not the stuff itself, but what we're doing, then it's the events can join better with the center, and as we can then maybe move collecting toys or something like that at the recenter, you know, sort of let the events, until we get to a different space, work upon a time, but so that we're promoting our recenter through our events. I think that is a real good use. It's like when you do a show, a guy I read ages ago in antiques, you don't do the show to sell stuff, you do the show to take names of getting new customers, so they in the future are your customer base.
Mm-hmm. It would be good if the tag sale donated things to the recenter at the end too, instead of just all trucking it out. If there were things that made sense.
Yeah, well, I'm awful glad that the Salvation Army does come, because otherwise we'd be having to do a lot more sorting.
That's a whole lot of sorting and collecting to do at the tag sale, because you're just busy trying to get people out of there at the end of the day.
Yeah.
That's a lot of work. Mm-hmm. I was just going to add one more thing. I think any means that we can do to get people to reuse is good. And if that's what it takes to get people to clear out their basements and get rid of stuff and not trash it, if they want to make a little money on it, it's good.
It's a tag sale.
It's a tag sale. It's a good, great service for people who are moving and live in apartments and can't do their own. It's mm-hmm. it's a good service. It's.
I will say there were less professionals at the last one than before, noticeably less professionals. So
that's good.
Yeah. No, I mean, two guys from Holyoke didn't come, and uh-huh.
Yeah, we couldn't do that. We didn't do the costume swap either, so we threw a bunch of costumes in a box, and the kids were having a great time going up and trying stuff on, and yeah. it was just a little box, but it was
fun.
It was a meager substitute, but it worked.
Well, I'm going to suggest that we take this and capture this information, and I will look at holiday dates, and I will talk to the Gazette. And next time we can just hash out and have a final kind of, I'll do a proposed thing based on our discussion, and then we can hash it out.
And people should think about what events they want to coordinate, in order to who's going to take the lead for each of the events.
Yeah, and I do have some new business, so I just wanted to make sure.
Let's move to it. We're going to have to postpone the fundraising discussion once again.
So, new business. First of all, I told you about the NERC and the South Deerfield Library. I don't know if you saw Green Living this week. I don't know how often it comes out. Winter. Pass the tape on and pass it.
Where was
it's
that?
All about. I haven't looked at the article yet, but I picked up a bunch of them because it's about Re. It's all about the Re, the world of Re.
Let it Re.
I bet we inspired that. We might have inspired that one. I also wanted to mention that. I met with Debbie because a conversation that we had kind of spiraled into the concept. Every year we look for a topic for our reduce, reuse, recycle insert that I do with Amy from Franklin County. And we thought maybe this was the year to focus on reuse. So I haven't proposed it to Amy, but Debbie and I just did some brainstorming about that. And if you guys would be psyched and interested in participating in some way, whether it's article generation or ideas, or let me know. I also wanted to mention, I think I might have mentioned it before, but I wanted to reiterate that the Department of Environmental Protection is going to be starting a big textile recycling campaign, awareness campaign. This year, it's coming sometime this spring. I think that they were talking about launching it around Earth Day. There's going to be a website with information about where people can bring textiles, what kinds of textiles they can bring, and they're really making a big push.
Would we be a site at the recenter?
It would probably be more the Salvation Army's box locations. So it's organizations that collect and where they collect. So people will be able, I believe, to have locators to find where the boxes are. One issue that came up at this meeting that I attended that was a really interesting concept is, as exciting as it is, and there is a lot of material out there available for people, used textiles have become a real commodity. And the market is growing very fast. So more and more organizations and businesses are interested in capturing this. And so what that does is it makes the whole decision-making process of
what box to have and why, a much bigger deal. So there's some for-profit organizations that are out there that are actually displacing, in some cases, the nonprofits, because the nonprofits used to be able to have a box for free at the such and such shopping center that they would empty. So now a for-profit organization comes in and says, well, we'll pay you $20 a month for that spot. And then, you know, sometimes in some cases the charitable one can get booted because now they're having a paying resident there in that space. So, and then what happens to the clothing? So some places sort the clothing locally or regionally and then send some to the recycling facility and some that gets baled and sold overseas. Some places don't do any sorting and they just bale it and send it to auction. And environmentally, that there's some concerns for me at least, because if you just bale and you don't do any sorting, they're getting rags and stuff like that that they may or may not have the capacity to handle. They might also be in sub-Saharan Africa might be getting winter coats. And you know, what's the point of that? So different organizations do things differently. And so it really makes the choice of what box to have at a location a lot more complicated, because there's lots of good from this promotion, and it's going to make things more complicated as well. I was told $200 a ton-ish is the value of used clothing and textiles, and that's pretty nice. So there's a whole bunch of groups that are popping up that are doing this kind of thing.
I'll have to go through my closet.
I attended a municipal recycling coordinators meeting yesterday morning, and Jared was there actually, and he was talking about the percentage of, you know, some of the same statistics that he had thrown at us about the what it costs to pick up material and blah blah blah.
Right.
And it was very interesting, and people were very. We had municipal recycling coordinators from the whole Pioneer Valley, and there were a number of people that were really enthusiastic about the level of service that they've received from Salvation Army, and I thought that was interesting. People seemed very happy with that. Alternative Recycling Systems has opened a new transfer station in the Springfield area called K&W, and I wanted you to know about that. And so they are getting into the private transfer station business.
K&W?
K&W. K&W Materials and Recycling. At this point, it's largely commercial people that are using it, but they're working in collaboration with the city of West Springfield, and they're working out a system so that West Springfield residents can go to this.
So is it like what Valley?
It's like Valley Recycling, except a little bit more extensive, I think. They're going to take brush, they're going to be selling mulch, they're going to take bulky waste, asphalt, brick, concrete, all that kind of stuff. So I wanted you guys to know about that.
Where's asphalt, did you say?
Asphalt, brick, and concrete.
Construction
materials. Yeah, there's a list of... There's a whole bunch of items that are banned from incinerators and landfills in the state of Massachusetts, and asphalt, brick, and concrete is one of those groups, and you're not allowed to throw it in a landfill. But
Willard's takes it now.
Willard's takes it locally.
Yeah.
That's where people take it around here. Yeah. And then the last bit I wanted to say was that Veronique Blanchard did a little blurb on swap shops. And Veronique is the South Hadley Recycling Coordinator, and they had also asked if I would do a little blurb, and there was no time, so all I got to do was send out our, give out our brochure. Arlene seems to think that our recenter is a completely different class of swap shop. And while that's kind of flattering, it's also, I disagree. I think it's...
Well, why does she think that?
Well, she said, oh, you're in a different class. You know, because I don't know why she thought that. I'm a little confused why she thought that. And I think because of the level of volunteer support, maybe. But one of the things that...
Or maybe because it requires volunteer support, whereas a lot of the other swap shops are pick up and drop off.
Yeah, it's possible, but what's interesting is that Veronique said that, she reiterated some of the things that Mac and I had spoke about when we were doing the, what was that called, webinar with the NERC people. We did a webinar on reuse events mostly, but we talked about, you know, volunteers are critical to make any of these things happen, and Veronique was very supportive of this. She said I wouldn't be able to do it without her volunteers. So she has a much simpler kind of system, but a lot of the same elements are there. She has, I was looking for my paper, which I'm not finding, but they have rules in South Hadley. You can only take 5 things a day. You can only come for 20-minute periods of time. You can come for 2 20-minute periods of time. So they have these rules that they, and she, it sounds like she's out there most Saturdays. So they actually enforce these rules, which takes some administration. So I don't see how that's different from what we do.
Well, we don't force people out after 20 minutes.
I'm sorry?
We don't force people out after 20 minutes.
We want people to take more than...
You got to go.
Right, but we ask. I would say 20 minutes is about the average time that other people...
Sure.
And we do have inside our rules, we have rules inside, and we ask people to limit their visit to 30 minutes. So
we tell people to take more things.
Yeah, right. We have an open
basket. So here is, this is the rule. She said item limit is 5 items from the swap shop, and 1 large piece of furniture per day and per family. No limit on children's books or toys.
No limit on children, I thought.
Yep. And
maybe they just have higher volume, and they get more stuff and they have more people coming through. What is, how long have they been open?
They've been open for 5 years or so. I mean,
okay,
so we might want to. I didn't remember if anyone had visited South Hadley.
I don't know. I haven't.
And how often are? I mean, what days?
Every Saturday, I think. I don't know. She doesn't say.
Did she say?
It sounds like it's just Saturdays because she. It sounds like she's actually physically out there herself.
Yeah.
Did she say why they have a limit?
It's year round except for the furniture part because they don't have a covered area. They just have little
okay,
sheds,
John.
Sort of. Thank you, John.
Yeah, sorry.
So she said that the problems were parking issues because people come and camp and they ran out of parking, and fighting over items. Those were the two problems. So I just wanted to share that with you guys.
Do I have a motion to adjourn?
Wait, I have another
new business. Another new business? Okay.
I think I just wanted to bring up, maybe Peter does too, but I just wanted to bring up the fact that I just heard today, well, 2 things. First of all, the board appreciated your recenter, and David pointed out it was just 1 piece of paper, somebody else pointed out, and you made changes by hand or something like that. Anyway, everybody looked at it and read the stories. The second thing is what I heard today and what I've heard before is that we have a need for volunteers, and I just wanted to mention that I've heard that several times, so it's something that might want to bubble up in terms of allocating time and effort. So
yes, that is what I'm on. I called the office of the president of Smith College, President McCartney, that's her first name, talked to her assistant and said I would write a letter about that we could use interns and volunteers. I called it interns and volunteers because I think research probably is one thing we could really use some help on, and possibly if it became a program, an actual program in the material science end of things. So is there anything else that we could be asking Smith College while we're here? Any for help in what we're doing. That's all I could think of right now.
Backup for as a space to do events.
They have an environmental club that we've never been able to be successfully integrated with, and they have a sustainability officer by the name of Dano Weisbrod, who I happen to be meeting with next week. So
Dano,
DanoWeisbrod.
I have his contact info. The admin that works with him is really great. So
Joanna.
I don't remember her name. It's in.
Yeah, if we go the iFixit route, where you have to teach people how to fix their stuff, you need really good teachers, and you also need a space with a lot of good equipment. So maybe the engineering department, maybe some of those students would like to lead some workshops.
There's a Sarah
Kirk, brainstorming here.
Or at least she used to be there.
Okay.
Sarah Kirk. She works for Seeds and their sustainability groups
at center there. Ro, what was your point about the volunteers?
I'm just wanting to know how we're going to be proactive about that. And if it's it needs to be on the next agenda,
mm-hmm.
or whatever. Because I think that we need, that's, I hear it at both our Tuesday meetings. And
it'd be really nice to have a bunch of task forces or subcommittees that aren't just people from here.
Right.
Working on stuff.
Well, we talked, when we first talked, we were talking about the recenter, we talked about having a volunteer coordinator.
Yep.
And David has been serving as that by default, and because he's generous and happy to do it. But it would be, part of that is recruiting, and, it's a pretty big job. So we need to either get clearance that it's going to officially be a part of my job, or find somebody else to do it.
Who would give you clearance that it's an official part of your job?
The supervisor.
Who's that now?
Yeah.
Jim
Morello.
Mm-hmm. So
why would that not be part of your job?
Because I'm still 20 hours a week, and
I understand.
Projects. So it's a priority.
It's a
priority.
Yeah. So you would have to do it as a proposal about how you use your time.
Which opens a bigger discussion about what they feel.
But David's always been clear about coordinating, but not recruitment, and that what we're talking about is recruitment.
Right.
When we talked about opening a recenter initially, I felt the first dollar we should spend would be on a volunteer coordinator.
Mm-hmm.
Because having been involved in a lot of nonprofits, I
yes.
know that's what either makes something work or not.
Is it possible that we can pay someone to do it?
We only have the $7,000 left in our line item, and I don't think that would pay for a volunteer coordinator. There was a push, some of us on the board made a push to increase Susan's position to a full-time position, and getting community development funds from using the argument that this is a community service, not just part of
solid waste.
Yeah. And that never went very far, or there wasn't enough discussion about that. But and there was money left over, so it's like, well, we don't need more money. And I think and to be honest, everybody is very happy with Susan, but she wants to be part-time right now. So that might also be unspoken. And nothing is going to happen in the next few months because we don't have a director, and Jim is pretty much underwater. So just to throw all that out. I mean, I'm addressing major issues that our group suffers from, or needs in terms of resources.
Is Jim a candidate?
Which is not to put pressure on you, just to be clear.
No, it's good to put it out there.
I think it's the way we organize ourselves, too. Because right now, for the first several years, we've been willing to do the work.
Yeah.
And now, as we see, we need volunteers. We're getting volunteers. Mm-hmm. I mean, the Toy Swap had a lot of, you know, civilian volunteers.
But as our vision expands.
As our vision expands, we need to kind of reorganize the way we think about getting work done.
Absolutely.
But I don't want to minimize the importance of your role, because you do keep things organized and the whole online, I forget what the software that we're using, but that, yeah.
Sign up Genius, yeah.
All that's very good. Yeah. So that's a good thing. Mm-hmm. So there, I think we're working efficiently for what we have. It's just that this is a recurring thing.
Well, you know, and I never am one to, well, I shouldn't say that. I you know, we're full of ideas, and it's all really good stuff. And sometimes we might need to just kind of scale back and say, you know, if we don't have the volunteers, maybe we're biting off more than
exactly
we should. Right.
Exactly, right. Just to keep the
It's hard to go there, but.
I think the spring reuse rally was the only time we felt that our volunteer corps was really short. I mean, at least all the times that I was at the reuse center, I felt like we had plenty of volunteers. Mm-hmm. You'd say that's true, Mac, Diana, when you were a supervisor?
It's generally true, but there's been some expression on some people's part that they don't want to feel like they have to go out there as often as they did last
season.
That's
right.
I think we're doing really good with what we've done, and we're establishing it, and right now we're just mostly just fine-tuning these events.
Yes.
But we really want to expand the mission, then we need to get outside groups. Maybe like getting a Smith College group running one of these events, or coming up with one of their own to expand the mission, so that maybe just have one person as a liaison, so that we're not doing everything for it.
Mm-hmm.
Have we gone to our email list to recruit volunteers?
Yes. That's how we started. And then anyone that got back to me, we created a reuse volunteer list, and that's who's on. That's why I was asking about the email list from the Toy Swap, because I don't know, before the reuse center opens in the spring, we will send another email out to our entire list that says, are you interested in volunteering at any of our events or at the reuse center?
Well, so this brings up the whole issue of the email list and the migration. I would like to migrate over to the MailChimp, which is going to allow us to do a whole bunch of things with maintaining the database. Right now we're in Gmail, and it's a very large mailing list to manage with Gmail, and MailChimp is designed for large mailing lists, and it's free. It's just a big project that I haven't been able to get to. Mm-hmm. So
the city doesn't have a way for us to use the city's email system?
Well,
they don't have what the email system they have is through Civic Plus, mm-hmm. and it isn't really a two-way, there's limitations. So I used it extensively in Amherst, the Civic Plus feature, and what you can do is ping people. It's really good for, you can send out text messages, you can send out email messages. The problem is you can only send them to those people who requested to be notified about the events. So that means that you could use our mailing list and tell people about the feature once we have it set up, and they would have to physically go and sign up to be pinged on those things. And MailChimp allows a lot more two-way communication. It also allows people to drop themselves very easily from a mailing list if they decide, you know, they can unsubscribe easily.
How many names are on our list?
We have 600, something
wow.
like that.
That's great.
Yeah, so the other issue is that firewalls see the number of people
right.
that something has been mailed to, and they screen it out as
spam.
Mm-hmm.
So because of that, I divided up our list into six lists of about 80 to 90. And so each time we send out an email, I actually have to send it out six times.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where, you know, you also have to remember to blank carbon copy up at each of those six lists.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't, then you get some anger.
Sure.
So it turns out, so each time we send out an email, it's kind of a big production.
Mm-hmm.
And it wouldn't be with MailChimp.
Right.
MailChimp has all of that organized. You say, I want it going out to these people. And
so what are the barriers to getting those?
It's finding out how about MailChimp and then migrating our stuff over.
And to what do you have to go through the Northampton technology person?
Yeah. I have to alert them, and the mayor might even need to be, you know, once we've
right
because you know they don't want a wild card
right
group.
Personally, and this is just my feeling. Mm-hmm. So I think that you're spending too much time having to think about all this, so whatever it takes to get past this,
yeah,
it's not worth your time to be thinking about the other stuff. So talking to the technology person and moving in that direction, or maybe he or she has another option.
Right.
I just hate
yeah
to see you having
yeah, I don't know that anyone else uses MailChimp. I don't know. I mean,
but maybe there's something
the
else
city
that they use.
Yeah,
that
there could be something else
knows.
Yeah.
From Rose Point.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
But the city should be able to do that for you.
Well, should and could.
Yeah.
But just
thought.
Yeah.
And then the volume.
Can I just give one more thought there?
Uh-huh.
You know, we kind of self-taught ourselves to become experts in what we're doing. Recruiting volunteers, that's a pretty specific skill that probably most people don't have. We're going to have to, if we want to get somebody to do that, we're going to either have to be lucky enough to find someone who's got that skill, or we're going to have to train somebody.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be some kind of mentoring system. So we might have to think about getting something like that set up.
But it is true that a lot of people are enthusiastic about what we do. And I've had a lot of people say, I'd love to help you guys. Mm-hmm.
Well, that's how we get them to help, though, is
right.
Them
so it's, but it's, but it's by constant pinging. I mean, we could even develop a campaign on Facebook to recruit more volunteers. That's something that could easily be done in the winter months.
Mm-hmm.
And start saying, you know, we're looking for volunteers for this, that, and, you know, so it's a matter of awareness building that we're looking for people and then getting people to actually make the call and make the connection and commitment to doing something with us.
I want to remind you that we're not short an army of volunteers. We're short a couple of handfuls of volunteers. And so we also don't want to be overwhelmed and have
that's
people
true
show up with nothing to do.
Good point. No, yeah,
yeah.
True. Yeah.
But
yeah
we could target
very
specific
true
skills when
yes
we're doing that. You could say, you know, yeah, we're looking for people who have these specific skills.
And I think having a web presence is one thing we can really concentrate. We
yeah
should concentrate this year. So that we have the e-center.
Susan, I'm happy to do some
yeah
data input in terms of email addresses and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
If we figure out what the system is.
Okay. Okay.
You know, obviously, I already do that for our volunteers, and that's something I'm very comfortable with, and
okay
get that
that'd
quickly
be great, David.
Okay. Motion to adjourn.
Is there a second?
Second.
Yeah.
All right.
Whew.
We are adjourned.
This is a very productive meeting.